It needs a brake train.
Okay, but it also parks a stabilizer pelvis. Okay, and they stabilize your hip. You also have a lesser trochanter, so you have a greater trochanter, you have a lesser trochanter over here, and this is where your hip flexor attaches. This is how you lift up your hip this way, okay? This is blood supply, and this is important for understanding why we do certain procedures and why we do things a certain way. So the flow of the femoral head actually comes in the reverse way. The femoral head has a lot of cartilage, and cartilage can't really have holes for blood supply. You really don't want an artery traveling through your joint, right? Especially in a very constrained joint where there has to be a lot of movement. So it actually, it starts in the femoral artery, okay? And it has circumflex arteries, so these circumflex arteries come out from the femoral artery. They loop around the trochanters, okay? And after they wrap around, they then send blood vessels through the neck up into your head. So in a way, it's reverse flow. It's not going directly in the head itself. It's actually coming up from the trochanters into the head. Now, the hip fractures are classified by their location, so femoral neck, intertrochanteric, subtrochanteric. So remember back here, we sort of talked about those regions, so that's where your trochanter, that's the trochanter, that's the hip, this is where the capsule, that's the socket. Okay. So we classify by their location, and the reason why we care about that is because, one of the reasons we care about it is because it's multiplying. So a femoral neck fracture happens here, so this is the area of the femoral neck, okay? An intertrochanteric fracture happens between the two trochanters, so at the level of the trochanter, so through here or through here, okay? And a subtrochanteric fracture happens below all of that, okay? The reason why we care is because femoral neck fractures have an issue with blood supply. Because the blood supply comes up in here, and you have a very displaced fracture, you're disrupting the blood supply, so the likelihood that the bone will heal in anyone, young or old, goes down the more displacement that you have, okay? And so for femoral neck fractures, the treatment for that is going to be a lot different than the other fractures where the blood supply is presumably preserved. This is one example of a displaced femoral neck fracture in one of my patients. You can look at the left side, that's the normal side, so here you see the femoral head, here you see the femoral neck, here you see the greater trochanter, here's the lesser trochanter, okay, this is as tab on the socket. And on the other side, right, you see the trochanters, you see the neck, but look, it's broken, that's where the femoral head is. So do you see that difference in the break? Okay. This is an intertrochanteric fracture, right? So not femoral neck. So again, on the left side, look, reference it for the normal side, the greater trochanter, lesser trochanter, the femoral neck, the femoral head, the acetabulum. Okay. And then you can see the fracture right here. So the femoral head and the neck are still attached as one piece, but the fracture is at this level. The one marked on the normal side is right here at this level. Okay. And you can see that's not just a simple break. There are pieces all over the place. Okay. So we talk about hip fractures and hip fracture treatments. Virtually all hip fractures are treated with surgery. This is a point that I made to all my patients, especially the ones who are hesitant about surgery. Like, oh, I'm worried about surgery itself. But we found that there's a lot of morbidity and mortality related to non-operative treatment in hip fractures. In fact, for me to agree to no surgery, the patient really has to be sick, like has to be critically ill to the point where they will not survive the surgery. Okay, and even patients who are very sick, have a lot of medical problems, we still push for that. The reason for it is multifold. Okay, one is pain. Right, it's painful to have a broken hip and be lying in bed. Okay, we wouldn't let you walk because it would just shift things more and the fracture would never heal because there's too much movement if you're trying to walk. You certainly can't put weight on it, right? Because your hip is broken, there's no way to do that. All right, and so the non-operative treatment would mean the patients sit in bed for 6 weeks until something heals. Okay, and they waste away. They get a tremendous amount of atrophy, even within the first week. Their pain requirements go up. Because they're lying in bed all day, they can't sit up. They can't aerate through the lungs, so they get pneumonia. Okay. And then they're in bed, so they get bed sores. Okay. So it's not simply they have a hip fracture that may or may not heal. It's all the other things that come with having to be in bed to avoid surgery. Okay. So again, virtually all the patients who have a hip fracture will get some form of surgery. All right. In fact, we've gone through in multiple studies to look at when we need a surgery, how urgent, and we found that the earlier you do it, the better. Okay. If you delay the surgery beyond 48 hours, we know that increases the mortality, increases the complications. Okay. And on the converse side, early surgery helps in immediately bearing. Patients get up immediately and walk the next day. They can and they can get up and breathe better and do their activities still, and they don't have to be in bed all day. Different types of hip fractures are treated differently, so this depends on the fracture configuration, so how much is displaced, where is the fracture taking place, okay, and that sort of determines the treatment from my perspective. So this is one example. This is a non-displaced femoral neck, okay. Again, you can see the neck over here, you can see the trochanters over here. The break is actually over here. It doesn't look all that bad, right? And if we actually get a CT scan, we see that on one part, on one side, you can't really see a fracture line. You can't see a step off between the two cortices. But you look up in here, you can see that there's clearly some sort of step off, so if anything, the head was sort of crunched into the neck backwards, okay? But it's not, it hasn't really shifted that much, it hasn't really torn the blood vessels, right? So for this one, we can actually put in screws and just sort of secure it in place, okay? Some would even argue that you may not even need surgery for this, but I think most trauma surgeons would have to keep for surgery, okay, in most patients. Then you have the other side where you have a fracture of the femoral neck that we saw before that is completely displaced, right? So presumably the blood vessels are all being torn, right? It's not getting blood supply, so it's very difficult to heal this fracture, all right? And especially in osteoporotic bone, where it's not that strong, you can't get a good hold of it to secure it in place until it heals. So for these, we generally recommend some form of joint replacement. So this is what we call a hemiarthroplasty. Arthroplasty just means some sort of joint replacement. Hemi means half, okay? So in this case, all we did was just replace the ball and put in a stem, then we cemented it in place. And these patients can bury immediately because the cement secures that metal stem to the rest of the bone, right? So historically, we've treated all these with a hemiarthroplasty, but we're not doing anything to the socket side. That's less cartilage. And we know that metal against cartilage probably doesn't fare well. Metal usually wins against cartilage. So this sort of has a lifespan, right? In general, we say about 10, 15 years. So while it worked great for someone who's 90 years old and they'll probably outlast that hip, someone who's 70 years old or 60 years old, they have, hopefully, a long time to live and they might outlast that hip, which means that metal may run may cause too much rubbing. It's probably to cause it to wear out and lead to arthritis on that side. So in the past 10 years, we've actually looked at doing a total hip replacement. Has anyone heard of a total hip replacement before? Yeah, you've seen like ads for it. So people actually advocate doing a primary or acute total hip replacement for these patients, especially younger, active people. The idea is that these patients are active, so they're trying to live longer, and the total hip allows them to do more activity, and you're not worried about the metabolic burning out the cartilage on the other side since you're replacing both sides of it. Okay? And the results are showing that promising in that patients actually do better with the total hip, especially the younger ones across the board. Okay? But they do have risk. Total hips do have a higher dislocation rate because it has a much smaller head to it. So because the radius of that head is a lot smaller, to dislocate, it needs to travel even less distance than, let's say, a hemiarthropod that has a very large head. Okay? As we talk about intertrochanteric fractures, okay, so this is again through the level of the trochanter. That's a greater trochanter, that's a lesser trochanter. Right? We can put in a screw, all right, to stabilize it. So with this particular pattern, all right, the hip wants to travel this way, right? Imagine putting your weight through your hips, and the bone actually wants to travel down this way, all right? But it may also slide down this way. So the purpose of this hip screw is to actually almost act like a buttress. By putting the screw in, I'm engaging the head, and I'm allowing the fracture to almost collapse on itself, so it's compressing itself. That's how this particular screw works with this particular fracture. This is one of the standard ways we use to treat intertrochanteric fractures a lot, but the tides have actually shifted. So same type of injury, right, in an intertrochanteric fracture. Again, you see a fracture line over here, you see the greater trochanter over here, the lesser trochanter over here, so intertrochanteric fracture, all right? And we've actually now switched more over to using nails, okay? A nail is basically a metal rod that goes within your bone, okay? So basically it goes down the bone, it's a shaft, and it can be short, it can be long, there's no difference between the two. And then similar to the other example I showed you, there's a screw that goes into the head itself and engages the femoral head, and these two parts of it lock it in place so that when the hip is stabilized, it remains and keeps it stable. And because we're actually from the inside, the patients can immediately wiggle through. After I fix one's hip, I lock the entire wiggle immediately, and that is the goal, try to get them on their feet, try to get them moving, prevent bone clots, prevent their area, improve their pain, get better aeration in the lungs. These things are really important early on as soon as I can, and so I make my patients eat all the meals in a chair, okay, so they're not sitting in bed all day. I make them at least get up to the edge of the bed as often as they can, okay? This would then be really interesting.
ぜひお召し上がりください。